orthopedic conditions. So over to Dr. Manish.
Yeah, good evening, everyone. Welcome you all to this session where we're going to discuss about the regenerative science. Officially, I'll welcome everyone here to Indian Stem Cell Study Group Association. It's the academic body in India for regenerative science, having scientists and the clinicians working hand to hand together in uplifting the knowledge of the regenerative science. Well, the topic which is assigned to me this evening is a very interesting topic: why we need regenerative science in modern medicine. Actually, what is the role of regenerative science in the modern medicine? Now, regenerative science is an upcoming science which is very important for the clinicians, for the surgeons, because after some level of the treatment modality which we provide to the patients, we are unable to do the things to that extent which should be done. So what and where are the clinical needs of the regenerative science, the modern medicine, that we are going to discuss in another 45 minutes from now, how we are supposed to deal such patients. The future of the medicine and the surgery is definitely now reaching to a next molecular level, biological level, because whatever in by 2020 we are in, crossing so many decades, we are now on the apex of the surgical speciality which we are dealing. But we are lacking at some point, which is taken care by the regenerative science. We can see the evolution, and this is a very normal picture which has been taken and which is present in a lot of textbooks. So the evolution of the man into the state of the stability is now to the flexibility. And with this COVID in 2020, this flexibility is more on the digital level. We are here on the Zoom, for example. So we need to reach to a more bottom level about what we can do actually. And before moving to the main topic, I should make everyone aware about that by 2050, we would be having memory chips implanted in the doctors, you know, because so much surgical medical skills will be there. So these chips would be taking care of us. The practical residency of maybe, you know, 6 months of time would be good for having a learning, a coordination for the surgical and the medical practice. Similarly, by 2060, we could have a robots also coming into it. So it's again the silicon chips which is doing it. See, today we are on Google, right? So by two decades back or three decades back, whenever we want to see a reference, we need a book. Nowadays, everything is on the hands and our computers and our mobiles. Similarly, what we are going to have by 30 years from now, 40 years from now, is something like that. It's some intelligent machines, intelligent idea. Regenerative science is a science, and everybody can appreciate that when we were students, we were not able to know a word about the regenerative science. But now, in a decade of time, for example, in India, we know a lot about regenerative science. So it is a requirement. It is an innovation. Being an orthopedic surgeon, my specialty is orthopedic. So definitely, I'm more interested in biomechanical role of the regenerative science, because orthopedics is already a bone correction, a mechanical job. So we need a positive biology into it. So let us have a small journey about what is actually regenerative science. So our body tissues, every tissue of the body means, you know, bones, joints, soft tissues, they harbor the stem cells. Stem cells, which because they are capable to maintain and repair the regenerative the tissue in the body. What are the stem cells? They are uncommitted cells, just like a blank checks, you know, uncommitted cells with the capacity of an unlimited renewal ability. This is a mixed gathering. I hope many students are here. So I'm just starting from the base. So these uncommitted cells, they are the boon for the medical science, for the research, because they have an ability to differentiate under an appropriate condition, right? We all know and we all appreciate that there are three basic types of the stem cells, hematopoietic stem cells, which can differentiate to blood cells. And we are using this in treating leukemia since many, many decades, say maybe like 1990s. You know, by 90s, we are using it wonderfully well in the treatment of leukemia. Mesenchymal stem cells, they can differentiate to muscles. Muscles means even the heart, cardiac muscles, to bones, to cartilage, and various, every tissue of the body, you know, every tissue. And the third is the neural stem cells. So what are the sources from where the stem cells can be procured? So as the name itself indicates, we have five sources here. Embryonic stem cells from the embryos, fetal stem cells from the fetus, umbilical cord stem cell from the umbilical cord. So this is a very hot cake in different part of the world, especially in India and also at different places. When a gynecologist, while going for a delivery, they may require, if the parents want, to preserve the umbilical cord or the placenta, right? Because they are rich in the MSC, mesenchymal stem cells. Then the placenta-derived stem cells, again the same. And last but not the least, is the most interesting and most uniformly present, is the adult stem cell. So almost all the tissue in the body is having stem cells. All the tissue means skin everywhere. So there is an endogenous pool of stem cells everywhere in the body, in all the organs of the body. But the bank, the rich source, is only two from where we can procure. And that is the bone marrow or the adipose tissue, from where it can be taken. The uses of the adult tissue-derived stem cells are being preferred over the embryonic stem cell. That is very important. Yes, because it is more easy, it's more, you know, legally it's more better and more ethical importance is there. But the most important thing beyond all these things is the tumorigenicity of the adult cell is far lower than embryonic stem cell. And we all appreciate that at least we want to give some relief to the patient or the person for the trials, you know, rather than to come into a certain loop or a network of problems. That is why we should avoid embryonic stem cells till now, at least. So this is a general placenta, piece of placenta here with umbilical cord. So this is the rich source for the mesenchymal stem cell. And here you can see the Wharton's jelly. This is a transverse section of the umbilical cord, having umbilical artery and the umbilical vein. So this is rich in the stem cells, mesenchymal stem cell. To be more practical, the stem cell is, you know, the better term is to use is as a progenitor cells. So on comparison, these MSCs or stem cells, which derive from cord, they are more better actually than the amniotic tissue. So this is the best source, but because of the ethical reason, it's little dicey to be decided whether it should be used or should not be used. As I've already mentioned, the hematopoietic stem cells, they produce the RBC, WBC, platelet every time they are producing it. And the mesenchymal stem cells, they give rise to different, you know, repair different part of the body. Maybe like the stem cells lying in the brain, they give rise to neural cells. Every time everything is repairing, you know. Hematopoietic stem cells are so important that if in a nuclear accident, if a nuclear accident occur to the world, to the globe, then nobody can survive within a few days of time because HSCs would be destroyed. So the clinical use of these hematopoietic stem cells is being used for many years for the leukemia, and that is boon for us, and that is always a, you know, an initiation for doing a good research and for using the mesenchymal stem cells. Now, another classification of stem cell is based upon the ability to differentiate. So totipotent stem cell, which can form a full individual, you know, a zygote, a fertilized zygote, is a totipotent stem cell. Pluripotent, which can be undifferentiated cells, which are there in the, you know, 7th to 8th rate of the fertilized egg, and that they can produce the ectoderm, mesoderm, or endoderm. And the last, and but not the least, is again the most important part, that is the multipotent stem cells, which are differentiated. Yes, they are differentiated cells, which can form different tissues, and they are being present at all the places which we have discussed just now, specifically the adult stem cells in the body, they are multipotent stem cells. So by now we are able to understand that what is a multipotent stem cell, what is the adult cell. So this is a flow diagram showing everything, you know, a totipotent cell, a pluripotent cell, this blastocyst stage having the pluripotent cells, and finally the multipotent cell, the fully mature cell, which can give rise to each and every tissue of the body which has been required. Now, as I've already mentioned, that stem cell we procure from bone marrow or we procure from fat. Being an orthopedic surgeon, I'm interested, and this entire talk would be on bone marrow derived stem cells. So stem cell niche is an area, a specific microenvironment where the stem cells are present. That is the bone marrow area, right? So in bone marrow, there are two sites which have been proposed. First is the trabecular bone surfaces, which you can see here, right? Second is the perivascular space. So these two spaces are richly having the niche, the area of the mesenchymal stem cells, progenitor cells, and different type of cells. And this is a little detail of the slide. Now, when a stem cell divide, each cell has a potential either to become a same stem cell so that their number can remain same in our body, or they can convert into a specialized type of a cell, which may be required like a muscle cell or red blood cell or a brain cell, whatever has been required. So this is what is called as asymmetrical or symmetrical cell division. Now this is very important to know the use of the stem cell, how it can be used, where it can be used. Asymmetrical cell division, as the name itself indicates, so a cell is going to divide into one daughter cell, which is just like a parental cell, and one daughter cell, which is a differentiated cell, which is actually a progenitor or differentiated cell. This asymmetrical cell division does not actually increases the number of the cells. So they are simply carrying out just to maintain the cell, and it's not very much, you know, commonly getting in. Now, symmetrical cell division, here we can produce two identical daughter cells, and this has been used in vitro for proliferating the cells. For proliferating the cells, for increasing the cell amount, we need to go for a symmetrical cell division. So the resident stem cells, which we are talking about, which are living in our body at all the places, they live silently and divide infrequently. So by asymmetrical cell division, they divide so that their number remains the same. But as the age increases, as the person gets old, definitely this capacity decreases. All the things in the body, all the organs in the body, they have a declining phase, right? Now in the vitro for the culturing, we require a symmetrical cell division that I already expressed. The capacity to proliferate is often associated with the chromosomal abnormality, and that is a problem. These chances of getting a mutation, that is a problem. So that is why the cultured cells should not be used. Specifically, more than 3 to 6 passages is very risky to be used. So that is why, you know, in India, the ICMR and the other guidelines which we say we should not be able to use it. And that is why the rigidity cells have got little stigma that where it should be used and how it should be used. Now the progenitor stem cells, which are present at all the places, all the organs, you know, they typically generate the cell type of the tissue which they reside. Suppose we are talking about the progenitor cells in the liver. So if the liver is progenitor cell is there, it's going to produce the same cell type, you know, for the injury. So that is also for the, you know, at all for the bones specifically. Now, as I've already mentioned, there are two types of stem cell, hematopoietic and mesenchymal stem cell. Hematopoietic stem cell, this is the bone, having bone marrow, having both the stem cells here, hematopoietic and mesenchymal. Definitely hematopoietic, they are more abundant. And depending upon their surface marker, they have been named accordingly, 34, 45, 133, and there's so many of them. Mesenchymal stem cell or the adult stem cell or the progenitor stem cell, which you're talking about, they are relatively rare cells, which are totally, again, undifferentiated cells. And depending upon the surface marker, they're again being named for the users. Now, the mesenchymal stem cells are undifferentiated cells, which are residing at different places, which we have already discussed. And whenever they're required, they convert into the required cell type. For the orthopedics, we are more interested in osteoblasts, chondroblasts, But as I've already mentioned, with the age, these MSCs, they decrease with the age because that asymmetrical cell division is more, less, and with the time, you know, it decreases. Now, characteristically, these mesenchymal stem cell, they are the mononuclear cell with a spindle-shaped body, having a long, thin cell processes, and they are technically called as a mononuclear cells. And as I've already mentioned, every tissue is having it. I'm repeatedly maintaining it because we should be able to understand what is its importance actually. Now, how the stem cells work? What is the principle? Just like if you have a sore throat, you take antibiotic, it reaches to your required tonsils to take care of it. Similarly, the stem cells, they have a beautiful capacity of reaching to the home, the target tissue which is being required, which is being diseased. Whenever you inject it intravenously, or definitely if you're going to place in a local position in the body, maybe skin, maybe joint, so it's going to reach it there. After reaching to the site, that is the homing is there, the second thing comes into it, that is plasticity, interconvertibility. These undifferentiated cells, they convert into the cell type which is required. Suppose it is reached to the liver, so it required to regenerate the liver, right? Suppose reach to the brain, so they require angiogenesis. So likewise, according to it, this is a what is called as the plasticity. Third is engraftment. It has been presumed that yes, whatever the cells has been created, they get regenerated, they get amalgamate, unite with the tissue, and persist for the present person's lifetime. So for example, whatever regenerative science we use in orthopedic, for example, for the critical limb ischemia, once the job is being done, it is being done presumably at most of the places. So we feel that engraftment is also the thing which is working. Once homed these cells, the first job is to have an anti-inflammatory effect because they regulate the inflammatory associated biological process such as suppressing the macrophages activation there, suppressing the natural killer cells, T cytotoxic cells. So that is the anti-inflammatory, a beautiful function which gives immediate relief to the person. So these mesenchymal stem cell in bone marrow is again being mobilized whenever is required by the use of the GCSF, which has been released with the injury or whenever it's been required. And in fact, in infertility, it has been also been used very commonly. Now, in case of soft tissue injuries or in case of fracture, how the healing is there? We, for the decades, we are able to note when a fracture is there, it's going to heal. Callus is being formed. That's all. Fine. So we are just entering into the microscopic level so that we should be able to appreciate how it is important and how we can use it in the modern medicine. So whenever there's an injury, there is a fracture, there is soft tissue injury, there is damage, you know, the platelet release their growth factor. Similarly, the GCSF is being released from the endothelial side, from the site of the injury, from the macrophages. Both these cells, both these factors, they finally stimulate the bone marrow to release the account, to release the soldiers to come to the site to fight and to treat the cause. So MSCs, they similar like the, these platelet, the mesenchymal stem cell, they are also good in releasing the growth factors, different growth factor, entire big list, which is not possible to be described in detail. But yes, definitely VGSF, vascular endothelial growth factors, collagen type 1, fibrin, they're very good factors, which are very important. For the orthopedics, and not only for the orthopedics, also for the, you know, for the cerebral injuries cases, for the stroke, everything what we require is angiogenesis. Angiogenesis is the basic for everything which can give a good result. So that is a base for the orthopedics. Here is a beautiful chart explaining how these adult stem cell, which I have just mentioned just now, mesenchymal cell, they release the growth factor. And ultimately what is required is the paracrine effect. The platelets are again giving the paracrine effect. We want the vascular endothelial growth factor, other growth factor to come in to help in the proliferation, the endothelial cells, and finally the angiogenesis occur. If angiogenesis occur, the most of the problem for the orthopedics and the cerebral injuries or the brain or the stroke is going to take care of it. But definitely, yes, the immunomodulatory function of mesenchymal stem cells, must not be forgotten. And the last lecture, just which we have covered, it has been beautifully mentioned how the rheumatoid arthritis with the you know, the target therapy can be given. Similarly, the mesenchymal stem cell have got a very beautiful role because they can inhibit the B cells, they can inhibit the monocytes, natural killer cells. So, and the in the rheumatoid, we want the B cells to to stop the activity of B cells. So it is a boon for the mesenchymal stem cells role in the rheumatoid arthritis. And at the same time, they also allow, they do not allow the maturation of the monocytes. So finally, these mesenchymal stem cells, these progenitor stem cells, through their secretory function, through their immunomodulatory function, through their anti-inflammatory function, through their pro-angiogenic function, they are the boon, the pyrethrin effect which they produce, the platelet, the pyrethrin effect which the platelet has been producing. The life of the platelet is rich, the life for the mesenchymal stem cell is more, so they are more in demand actually. So the paracrine effect is again going to give a reward to the mankind. And although these mesenchymal stem cells have also the capacity to differentiate into the specific cell type, but technically whenever we give a dose of mesenchymal stem cells, either locally or intrathecally or intravenously, they are not being converted to a larger extent, to a limited extent, maybe 10% or less, even then less, they used to convert into the required cell type. But yes, since this is a topic covering all the things, so I have to cover in detail. Yes, they can be differentiated to culture, they can be differentiated to osteoblasts, they can be differentiated to adipocyte, chondrocyte, whatever you require, they can be differentiated. But the only issue is, we should be restricting to the passages. We should not move more than 3 passages. And definitely they require a microenvironment, and microenvironment means what? We need a particular media. And this is a big list, a busy slide actually, a big slide where you can see for the chondrogenic differentiation, we require dexamethasone, ascorbic acid, etc. We all know. Suppose you want a big culture of a symmetrical cell division of the osteogenic differentiation for the osteoblast, it requires this type of culture media. Here we can see this osteogen differentiation of converting into osteoblast, firstly undifferentiated type, and by day 21, now a differentiated type of osteoblast can be seen. Again, a very important slide where we can appreciate how the mesenchymal stem cell, they can be committed to a required cell type for a chondrogenesis, for osteogenesis, for a myogenesis, for a tendon genesis. Yes, the tendon injuries, the tendon genesis, this can be done. So this already in our bodies, everything is going on. Just we are aware of the things now, so we can use it clinically whenever it's being required. So that means, what are the cells which have got a particular role in the stem cells in particular conditions? Like for years altogether, we know that the hematopoietic stem cells, they are blood-forming cells. The natural killer cells, we are now able to know, they are the target-killing cells that produce cytokines. Dendritic cells, they are immune responder. Mesenchymal stem cells, they can prevent the graft versus host reaction. That's a beautiful thing. So nowadays, even when you're doing a liver transplant, a renal transplant, this has been used. Similarly, the T cells, they prevent the graft versus host reaction. So that is wonderful. For those cases of the rheumatoid arthritis which are not being taken care by the DMRD, which are not being taken care with the biological drugs, they can be taken care by the T cells, by action of the these T cells in the rheumatoid cases. Finally, we can say that yes, bone marrow derived mesenchymal stem cell, they have got several advantages, as they are non-embryonic sources, they're non-tumorigenic, with little easy bits of isolation. They have a high expansion potential. They lack the immune response. That's the best thing. They're genetically stable, unless until we are, doing it for a lot of passages. They're reproducible. They're compatible with the tissue. They're all the, best things which are there with the mesenchymal stem cell. And that is the reason that in various studies it had been used for the repair. And at this juncture, it is very important to differentiate the mesenchymal stem cells of the bone marrow and the mesenchymal stem cells of the adipose tissue. As an orthopedic surgeon, we feel, and we have seen, and a lot of publications are also there, that yes, the mesenchymal stem cells derived from the bone marrow, they are more friendly in giving good results and repairing good in a better manner for the orthopedic reason as compared to the fat-derived mesenchymal stem cells. However, they are more in number as compared to in the fats as compared to the bone marrow. So every coin has both the sides actually. We all know about the PRP, in this lecture I have to cover by these two slides that PRP produced by the peripheral blood, and they have a platelet which is rich in platelet, and the aim is again the same, the growth factors which do the job. A small job can be assigned to the PRP because of the presence of the PDGF, because of the presence of the VGF. So a lot of repair work can be done. So it is a mini regenerative science part actually speaking. Now, when we are discussing about the bone marrow, the mesenchymal stem cells, so we should know what is the bone marrow harvesting and how the processing is being done actually. So a very common picture which you can see in many books also, from the posterior superior iliac spine, the bone marrow can be procured and by placing the needle in the space. Of course, it should be in the perivascular space, so have a good account. In the clinical practice, cold centrifuge machine are being used for separating these bone marrow stem cell or the BMAC concentrate, obtaining BMAC concentrate. The separated bone marrow mononuclear cells are being used for the clinical trials for various research purposes. After centrifugation, the cocktail which is obtained is having a lot of mononuclear cells, few hematopoietic stem cells, and a very, very few mesenchymal stem cells, practically no actually, to be more pronounced. Technically, the protocol is simple. You have to take out 120 to 150 ml of bone marrow, or even a 50 ml of bone marrow in some cases, depending upon your kits, which has been taken in a kit having a heparin. And by the density gradients method of separation, it is being centrifuged, it has been separated. The total mononuclear cell count has to be checked. The viability has to be checked by the cell counters. And you have to place into account that how many CD34 counts is being there. A typical picture of a flow cytometer where the sample is being placed, so as to check the viability. Viability is very important for all the clinical trial. We should be able to, because unless and until we have to titrate all the samples at the same level, only then we are able to find it out in the particular case of the result is coming or not coming. So that level has to be maintained. And then a very interesting slide showing this layer, which is a buffy coat layer, so-called as, and this is in large view, showing a buffy coat layer having a small amount percentage of plasma along with the total nucleus TNC, total nucleated cells, WBCs, hematopoietic stem cells, few, and MSCs, very few. So this processing, it should be done in 4 to 6 hours. So this is a myth actually, that you take out a bone marrow and don't process it. If you're not going to process it in a golden period of 4 to 6 hours of time, you're not going to have again a good result. So earlier it's better, and FDA rules say that it should be within 6 hours of the time. And as I've already told you that in this concentrate which is obtained, we're having 0.00% of MSC, which is practically a big no. This autologous bone marrow concentrate has a lot of advantages, like it is autologous. So the rejection chances is less, number one. It is safe, so no side effects is there, probably. No ethical issues is there, but definitely you have to get your ethical committee clearance from your institute for getting any clinical trials. And they are with the permissive category of ICMR in India, if it has been properly been used. The aspirate, as I already mentioned, it's a cocktail of cells, specifically the cells having endothelial progenitor cells, which are important for the support of the vasculature. And ultimately we require angiogenesis, I've already mentioned and mentioning each and every time, Bone marrow concentrate enhances the level of MSC, but yes, bone marrow mesenchymal skeleton decrease with the age, that I've already mentioned. Now, being a foot and ankle surgeon, as been mentioned by Dr. Sanjay also introducing me, how I came into the regenerative science is very interesting, because being an orthopedic surgeon, doing a lot of correction on the surgical side, on the club foot, I used to see that the deformity get corrected. As you can see here, a foot deformity has been corrected. The patient has very wonderfully been corrected. Sorry for this picture, but the thing to be appreciated is by doing the ligamentotaxis, by doing fixators, by using fixators in orthopedics, we are doing a ligamentotaxis, we are doing a distraction. Whenever you're doing a distraction, we find that joint regeneration is there. You can see, if you can appreciate, a joint is being regenerated there. To my surprise, for decades and decades, since 1995 when I was operating these cases, so there was a regeneration of the articular cartilage, the regeneration of the joint on the distraction. So technically, this regenerative science was already been there in the decade, but we are only able to decode it now to appreciate that how the regeneration was being there by the distraction. Now, the probable clinical use of regenerative science in the medicines, starting with orthopedics, the first lecture, the previous lecture was already been showing a lot of, you know, fractures. So we orthopedic surgeons have a lot of challenges when the fracture don't unite despite doing best from our side. So this bone marrow mononuclear cocktail or mesenchymal stem cell can take care of lot of non-union fractures, lot of delayed union. When the fracture is not being united properly, it's delaying in uniting, then we can use it. If it is not uniting technically with all the best measures, you know, then we can use it. For example, I've just placed a slide for to make you understand here. So this is a normal femur bone in which the nailing is being done. And after doing nailing, after 6 months of time, the bone is still not being uniting. As you can see here, a gap is being there. And we have dynamized this nail, we have removed the screw, even then it is not being united. So in such a cases, if you place a bone marrow cocktail, you know, which is which can be used in your OT and your with the centrifuge in your operation theater, with taking out the bone marrow with ethical consent, with all the ethical thing, with your institutional ethical consents, with the patient consent, then yes, we can see here that after giving this bone marrow concentrate through the needle at this point, this X-ray is being taken another after 1 to 2 months when we can see a good appreciate callus formation is here. So this is how it can be used. Now, secondly, as we know, a lot of the problem is because of the lack of the vascularity. And there was a slide in previous lecture also where it was been mentioned that how the portion of the bone can be avascular. So similarly, there's a condition, avascular necrosis of the head of the femur, which is a very difficult, challenging situation for orthopedic surgeon, where we don't have any answers actually. Similarly, sometimes we have a femoral or tibial condyle, femoral or tibial condyle area of the necrosis. So here the tissue engineering principle can be utilized. What is tissue engineering principle? Tissue engineering principle means we use, definitely we use the cells, maybe a MSCs in the trials or a bone marrow cocktail. But at the same time, we use some scaffold. We use G-bone, for example, or some grafts, so as to incorporate these cells into it. And then definitely growth factors are there. And because of this, the results actually come. Now, the third thing is very interesting is, as I've already mentioned, the basic challenge with orthopedics is, lack of vascularity for the healing. Whatever the tissue in the body is having a lack of vascularity, maybe a meniscus in the knee joint, whatever the tissues are there which have less vascularity, they heals very bad. That is the reason for the nerves, they heal very bad. So the partial ACL tear, whenever there's a sports injury, a footballer injury, or if there is an ankle injury, a chronic ankle sprain, I'm just trying to make it very basic because this is a very, you know, crowd of so many students also. So whenever there is an ankle injury, whenever there is a knee injury, a lot of sports medicine, when there is an injury which is very partial, which is not total, where we are not supposed to go for any surgery, there, this regenerative science can give a better results. Now, coming to a very interesting picture, I think everybody is aware about the knee joint. So how a knee joint, a normal knee joint, is able to regenerate our day-to-day wear and tear, which we have in our joints while, you know, climbing upstairs, while jogging, you know. Now, the basic thing to remember here is that the synovial membrane, which is there in the joint, this is having a this actually produces synovial fluid, we all know. And this synovial membrane is actually a specialized mesenchymal layer, nothing else actually. And it produces the cells into N. So synovial fluid is rich in this resident mesenchymal stem cell. So every person in every human being, every every not even human being, every even a dog actually, any person who is young, who is a normal person, having a resident normal population of stem cells. But how they can be utilized to repair it? Sometimes they can repair it some extent. It is very important to emphasize here that the synovial fluid, which have the mesenchymal stem cells, progenitor cells, they have a property only to differentiate into cartilage, the chondrogenic property, as compared to the usual, property of the mesenchymal stem cell. Now here you can get the most of the answers. Our forefathers, our ancestors, who used to do a lot of physical work, they don't have much of arthritis problem. Their knees were or are more healthy. The reason behind is because when we use our joint, when you do a brisk walking, simply we are just trying to stimulate the progenitor cells lying there in the synovial fluid, lying there adjacent to the mesenchyme, to the synovial membrane. And they, when they are stimulated, they have a peregrine effect, they release the growth factor, they make your chondrocyte to proliferate. So it is a well-proven medical fact that if you walk, if you do a good brisk walking, your cartilage thickness increases, makes your cartilage healthy too many millimeters. And the reason behind is this only. So this has been used in clinical trials for osteoarthritis also worldwide, where we can inject the mesenchymal stem cells or we can inject the bone marrow cocktail. When we are placing it here, there, but that has to be taken care of in which knees it is going to use. It is not like that, that if you're having arthritis to a very serious stage of grade 3 and 4, you're going to a doctor, you're going to you're placing yourself for a clinical trial, it's not going to work. So the osteoarthritis, if it is osteoarthritis in grade 1 or 2 in early stage, then it works. Otherwise, the surgical intervention is the only answer. So even the weight-bearing X-ray has to be taken care of. There is a particular protocol for fixing a patient to this research module if it is required. I have just placed a picture here for your reference. So this is a patient where the osteoarthritis was there, a 63-year-old patient, a non-diabetic patient. November 17, this is a picture when you can see a damaged joint space. And gradually, a regeneration was being appreciated here, which can be seen here. Still not to a good extent, because this is a grade 3, reaching to a grade 3. Not a good case, but just to quote it, how it works. But the need is the awareness where it should be used in a proper way. So a lot of the pending question of the orthopedic is being answered because of the presence of the stem cell. For example, we all know that whenever there's a fracture, in a children, not only children, means even if there is a fracture in a dog, in a, a young dog or a young sheep, it's going to heal well, because there are more abundant number of the mesenchymal stem cells. There are more cells have been released, 10 times approximately more cells have been released per millimeter than the adults. And they're more released in the bloodstream. And the process is the same, that whenever there's an injury, the platelets are going to give the signals, the GCSF is being released, and that will stimulate the bone marrow to send the signals, to send the cells to the fracture site. So again, the same principle is being there, but the answer is there. The children, the thing is better as compared to the adults. Definitely genetic profile has got an influence. Sometimes the genetic profile is such that even if you do the best, you can't get a good result. Age of the person, definitely. Nowadays, with the presence of the cellular therapy, cellular science, the cellular theory, the biology, the definition of the non-union is being changed. The non-union is not being seen in the classical manner which you used to say. Nowadays, the non-union is being saying that the place where the progenitor cells have poor growth capacity, proliferation status, or the differentiation capacity, that is the space. So it has been experimentally proven by the flow cytometry. Fractures platelet releasing factors, again, the same thing which I have already discussed, so I'm not going to go into details. Now, the second thing, the critical limb ischemia is a very good situation, very challenging situation in the medical fraternity, because we know that there is a lot of burden of the diabetic population in India, throughout the world, and is going to increase also with the time. So because of the diabetes, there is a lot of, you know, critical limb ischemia, there's a lot of problems with the vascularity of the limbs, so people are having diabetic foot ulcers. Similarly, a Berger disease, a condition, similarly in the vascular ulcers, vascular non-ileal ulcer, this is again simply nothing but the diabetic ulcer, truly speaking. Here, this is very rewardious. For example, so we have a lot of patients with a paraplegia. So that is a, you know, that's a common thing in orthopedics and the medical science. And there are a lot of the wounds we encounter which are not healing because the patient is on the bed sore, so having a bed sore, a pressure sore. Now, I just kept this example just to make it you understand that sometime if the paraplegic patient, then they're not going to heal with the bed sores, even you are doing the debridement, then what is the solution? The reason for the bed sore is nothing but simply the avascularity at the side because of the constant lying down of the position. And the patient is already a paraplegic, the nervous system has already been involved. So there is definitely a involvement of the blood vessels, peripheral blood vessels also. In this case, after the debridement, we did a PRP for two intervals of time, not to appreciate that the PRP is going to heal it, but simply to make a bed, a proper bed, so that at least a vascular surgeon or a plastic surgeon can do the approximation. Because unless and until whatever you are going to do to this area, if you're not regenerated blood vessels there, if you're not able to do a new angiogenesis there, nothing is going to work. So for some ulcer, the PRP is fine. For a deep ulcer, for a chronic patient, it is not fine. So need at least, you know, some modality of the treatment where we can increase the angiogenesis. That is the main aim. So you can see here very well how it has been healed. Unfortunately, in this patient, again, repeated episodes are there. As I have already mentioned, the mesenchymal stem cell or hematopoietic stem cell, they have got a wonderful role in rheumatoid arthritis, all type of arthritis, you know, and, you know, systemic sclerosis, SLE, multiple sclerosis, ulcerative colitis. So you can feel that how much the burden of such patients is there in our society, on our globe, where the challenging treatment modality is still not giving a good result. There, the hematopoietic or mesenchymal stem cells can do the wonder. And the most important of it is diabetes. Not only type 1 diabetes, in the type 2 diabetes. So this is the, again, the rheumatoid. I think we are running, I have to cover, 15 minutes are left. So what are the other specialty uses stem cells? Stem cells can be used in liver cirrhosis in the clinical trial because, again, they can regenerate to liver, they can to some extent by stimulating. Idea is to stimulate the endogenous cells there, not to place your MSCs with the want that they're going to convert into the hepatocytes. No. Mainly, our idea is to have a paracrine effect. Similarly, in the neurodegenerative diseases like motor neuron disease, name it, it is here. Motor neuron disease, multiple sclerosis, Alzheimer's disease, Parkinson's, stroke, cerebral atrophy. Everywhere, the basic thing is what we require is neoangiogenesis. Maybe it's a case of a cerebral atrophy. This is a picture I've taken from the book. I mean, after the stem cell therapy, you can see what the PET scan is showing, the regeneration. So you can document it. It is the evidence base. In all these neurological cases, one thing which we most of time and our patients most of the time who are coming into the clinical trials, they miss is they are totally depending on the stem cell. No, it's not like that. It has to be a rehabilitation. I mean, the 50% job is done by the bone marrow cocktail or your MSCs or whatever the trial you're going to it. And 50% is the physiotherapy, the regeneration path, which is very important. In ophthalmology, it has been used in anterior posterior chamber condition. In interstitial lung disease, it can take care of lung fibrosis. Even in a dental surgeon, it is used for submucous fibrosis. Submucous fibrosis is a typical problem, especially in our country. where a lot of tobacco or worldwide where it has been used, you know. So this submucal fibrosis, the treatment is what? Simply to do angiogenesis. If you're doing angiogenesis, again, the problem will come down. In ENT setup, you can have a good role in the mutism also. That it has been tried. In gynecology, it has been beautifully been tried in infertility, in Usherman syndrome. Because the you know, the most of the time the infertility is because your endometrium is endometrium, the uterus is not healthy enough to hold the ova, to hold the fertilized egg. So it can take care of that part. In spinal cord injury, it is really in working stage right now. I can't comment most, but definitely in spinal cord injury, and whenever there is a nerval injury, there's no injury where there's demyelination, it has beautifully been used. Some even have tried in an early case of stenosis of spinal cord, you know, spinal canal, when there is acute PID. So it is again under trials for the spinal cord. So I'm just moving a little fast so as to cover it. Yes, as I've already mentioned in initial slide also, that in cardiovascular surgeries, it can be used, it is being used at somewhere while doing the bypass because it can regenerate the muscle. So your results can increase by using this stem cell. Cerebral palsy, the basic problem with the cerebral palsy is the angiogenesis is not there, the lack of vascularity is there. So by the cerebral, by this bone marrow cocktail, yes, by giving intravenously or mainly by intrathecally, because by intrathecally they can pass the blood-brain barrier and go inside, and they can produce the angiogenesis, the growth factors can be released. The main aim is again the paracrine effect, and it has been seen in the clinical trial that yes, the sparsity decreases, the drooling of saliva decreases, but again, it is, you know, a double-edged sword that where we have to really weigh what has been used. And definitely, we orthopedic surgeon accompany the surgical skill also, because sometimes a patient with a spasticity come to us, we want to operate, we can take care of the tendon, we can repair the thing, we can do the limb lengthening. But since the spasticity element is there, we have to take care of that portion also. So in that case, it can be used like that. So as to have a decrease in the hypertonicity and other things. Diabetes, yes, diabetes is a wonderful, even a type 1 diabetes, type 2 diabetes, type 1 diabetes with the pancreas, who are not able to function, the beta cells are not functioning, they can be stimulated, the beta cells, the endogenous cells which are lying down there, they can be stimulated to regenerate. And similarly, in type 2 diabetes, where the problem is basically the peripheral cells can't utilize, they can be stimulated by the paracrine effect again, with the stem cells uses. And here is a experimental model, which I'm not going to detail. But yes, the most important thing which is here is the most promising thing which is here is, yes, it can prevent the mesenchymal stem cell, can prevent the graft versus host reaction. So the liver transplant or renal transplant can be used. And the most important is, yes, mesenchymal stem cells can be genetically modified to express their anti-tumor mediators function. The bone tumors, it can be used, or in the metastasis, it can be used in treating certain amount of malignancies. So I'll just wind off everything with a lot of, it's an entire medical science can be boomed with the stem cells use. Few of here, again, I'm just emphasizing it. And the crux would be for orthopedic surgeons, for us, it is, placing a axe on our foot, as with the availability of the regenerative science, hopefully in the coming year, the requirement of the joint replacement should come if the clinical trials goes in a proper manner and if the patients are being caged up at the grade 1 or 2 so as to break the vicious circle. And already mentioned what is the use of MSCs, and definitely a brisk walking is a wonderful thing. And with this COVID time, when we are taking care of our health, this is again a boon. And now everybody will be able to appreciate that by doing the brisk walking, how you can regenerate. Not only this, even if you are doing a brisk walking, you are putting your pressure on your bone marrow, you're stimulating your hematopoietic stem cells to regenerate. You're improving your hemoglobin. Every answer to the medicine is there with the regenerative science. Stem cells application in medical science is likely for the future of the medical science and medical treatment. So bottom line, for me at for take home is here is that it is a highly useful modality if it has been used at a correct time with the correct pace. We all carry the action kits on our body. Everywhere the stem cells are there, we only need to rejuvenate them to make it use. And that is with the yoga practice, the medications, again, the same. We're just going back to where we were a decade back, and we should be like that. Here are a few references. A very thank to everybody. A warm thanks from Lucknow. Thank you so much. Here come to end of the session. Thanks so much. Dr. Sanjay, your mic is muted. Yeah.
Okay. Sorry. So thanks, Dr. Manish, for a lot of information providing to the students and giving us a very insightful talk. So we have a lot of questions. We'll go through some of the questions and that many of the participants have asked. So one of the questions is, are MSC have been used for muscular dystrophy, DMD?
Actually, truly speaking, BMD is not the candidate for the regenerative science. It needs a gene therapy.
Yeah,
and MSCs with the anti-inflammatory effect definitely can bring down the CPK level of these muscular dystrophy patients. But BMD, degenerative muscle dystrophy, is not the right cases to be attempted with this. And it needs a gene therapy. So that is a myth, actually. And it should not be given that has given a bad name also to many people who have been utilizing it.
Exactly. So the next question is, if we can differentiate and induce to neural stem cells, then why are we not doing it?
Well, actually we can see, actually, because of the, in India, with the criteria as laid down by ICMR, we are supposed to only use the bone marrow mononuclear cell cocktail which we obtain, and for the most of the places where the neural stem cell has to be used, it needs cultured neural stem cells, and it is not been permitted legally. And why to be used, actually, why we should, we are more interested to use a neural stem cell? Mm-hmm. See, the science is evolving. We just want to use in those cases where we can stimulate the endogenous stem cells. So we should try to rule in utilize our science at those places, and there you can use. I mean, even if in the case of a cerebral palsy, the child of a cerebral palsy comes with the 6 months, and you can separate the bone marrow mononuclear cell and separate the RBCs. And with your clinical trial, with your ethics committee approval, if you can pass it intrathecally, it will go to the brain, it will do the angiogenesis, which is the problem there, actually, and the things will resolve. So there's no need to use a neural stem cell technically for another 4 or 5 years, actually.
Yeah, another reason is that in any of the differentiation protocol, we don't get 100% cell differentiated. So what is going to be the fate of the undifferentiated cell? And how do you segregate the differentiated versus undifferentiated?
Fine. Because you are playing with the patient.
Exactly.
Why you are not allowed to play with the patient.
So exactly.
So
next question is, does any of the stem cell have been used to treat tropical, that is pigmented morphia or systemic scleroderma?
Technically, I have not personally used, but it has been reported that yes, the cells have been used, but a lot of publications have also been there. But I'll again say that in all these conditions, you have got endogenous cells lying out there in the initial condition. So if you can separate a BMAC and you can use it, then you can stimulate the pool of the endogenous cell. But if it is a disease where it is, you know, more to a genetical preponderance, in that case, it will not work.
Yeah.
But people have been used. I don't have any idea, and publication are there. But again, as an ethical constraint, I mean, technically, it's not allowed.
Yeah. So this is a good question. Is there any scaffold available that delivers BMP2 directly to the orthopedic wounds? And do you think nanoparticles will be used for targeted delivery in that aspect?
Yes, nanoparticle can be used, and scaffold we are using, as I've already mentioned in one case. But the scaffold, what we are using is for the fractures, the bone grafts or G-bone. For the arthritis, people are using scaffolds. But trials have been there. No results have been published. And I'll just want to convey this message that we don't have any sufficient data till date that this scaffold is better. Hyaluronic acid, some say hyaluronic acid scaffold is better. So people have got, now so many companies are there mushrooming throughout the world, coming to India also, where they're using hyaluronic acid as a scaffold for placing the mesenchymal stem cell. And definitely the role is better. But you need a clinical trial to, you know, come out with it that this scaffold is better or which scaffold.
Yeah, and especially then it determines like what kind of tissue you are going to generate, because for the correct bone and cartilage you need a very hard scaffold, like neural cells and other thing. You don't need very hard scaffold, you need little soft substrata so the cells can, or sometime if you are making a bone and cartilage, then you need a gradient scaffold from hard to soft so that it can actually make those stem cell, depending on the anchoring where they do, actually will make the tissue.
The scaffold has got a definitely very good role in the knee, when the cartilage has to be regenerated. For the bones, it's not a big problem, because in the bones, if you place your graft or G-bone, like then if you place your stem cell, the rest of the job will be done by the bone. But for the cartilage, for the joint where the movement is there, where it's very little chances of, you know, because staying is very important. Homing is very important. After homing, it is very important that these cells should stay there. So we should work on that area where we can give a scaffold where it is minimally, you know, it is more being accepted to the body.
So the related question is here, what are the specific criteria that should be met while designing bone tissue scaffold, especially in terms of strength and its original bone architecture?
Well, I think this is not the right choice question to me. You scientists can work on this better. As a clinician, I'm not able to say that which scaffold will be better.
Yeah.
So I'll not want to answer this question.
So if stem cell can differentiate and regenerate, then Parkinson's disease we treated with MSCs by differentiating to the neural stem cells.
Actually, yes. What happened that MSCs lifespan is more as compared to the platelets. We all appreciate. And when we place a BMAC, bone marrow concentrate, they have very few MSCs. So if you are placing a MSC, rich MSC, 40, 50 million unit of MSC IV in a patient of a Parkinsonism, it has been supposed that most of them will be, you know, trapped in the lungs. And then whatever the MSC is going to reach to the brain in the Parkinsonism case, what we are seeing the effect is the paracrine effect. That is the resident stem cells in the brain in that area, they get rejuvenated, they multiply and they differentiate into the proper cells. Not like that these 40 million MSCs, most of them are going to convert into the neural cells.
They hardly survive for more than a week.
So that is again a paracrine effect. So, but again, the trials, different trials have a different reports on that.
So the next question from Alisa is that, can MSC be used to initiate immune response to control biofilm formation and bacterial infection on orthopedic implant surfaces?
Can you repeat this question, please?
So can MSCs be used to initiate immune responses to control biofilm formation and bacterial infection on orthopedic implant surfaces, like titanium implant?
Yes, actually, work has been going on this. It's very inappropriate to comment on this right now, but definitely, see, what is happening is, even a PRP, a leukocyte rich or leukocyte poor PRP is able to do a, because of the anti-inflammatory effect, do the job. So I'm not able to comment much on this, whether it's going to be fruitful for the titanium implants or not.
Very difficult. So the next question again, how long the MSC injection need to be done for arthritis? So to answer this question, and maybe all the answer that is related to the cell therapy, I will just make a small comment that there are many unanswered questions still in the MSA field, that what actually is a good cell for the therapy and for which particular patient, how much cells actually we not be using for what particular therapy, when is the right time to actually do the cell therapy based interventions, and actually what is the actually fate of these cells in a long run. These are some of the questions that in the field still we are trying to answer them. And just to be sure that many of the stem cell therapy that we are saying is not straightforward, and many of the things are we are learning as we are going along. The more and more trial is happening, more and more process we are learning, and we have been utilizing for multiple different interventions. Yeah.
But actually, I do agree. And one answer to all these questions is why we want to use MSC for osteoarthritis. See, basically, definitely 30-40 million cells have to be placed in the joint in case of a osteoarthritic knee. But the aim is again to stimulate, I'll again repeat this thing, to stimulate the endogenous cells lying out there. So many of the cells lying out there, let us try to utilize those cells which are lying out there, rather than to take, because, unofficially, you are taking 40 million MSCs. It's a culture job, and unless until you are taking, you are procuring MSCs from a placenta, from umbilical cord, which are very good, the cost would be very much high for the patient, at least, or for the trials. So why to go for these MSCs when you can utilize the bone marrow cocktail? And definitely, but yes, technically for IV infusion, for Parkinsonism case, for a stroke case, for a liver cirrhosis, for a osteoarthritis, for a rheumatoid arthritis, IV, technically 40 to 50 million of the cells. But if these place IV, most of them are trapped in the lungs, not going to reach to the target site where they to convert. If you are placing it locally, then yes, they are staying there. But if it is placing the joint, whether we are having a right scaffold when we can hold these MSCs and let them to convert into it, the best would be to go for a BMAC to get for a right type of cases. If it is required, if it is failing, then in the next stage, you can go for the MSC. But again, if in India, you have to go for the clinical trials, and ICMR is not permitting. And it should not also like that to permit to go for a cultured cells.
Yeah, I agree. So next question is, can stem cell increase the bone mineral density?
No, actually, we have not. Nobody has tried to increase to use in the bone mineral density. That if the patient is osteoporosis, you can place a stem cell. I think it's a very vague type of a question. Because bone mineral density means what? Bone mineral density means you have to stimulate the osteoblast to have a more preponderance as compared to osteoclast. And stem cells needs a vascular space to reach it. So it's not like that if you're going to inject a stem cell, a BMAC or an MSC in an IV patient, if an osteoporosis is going to reach to the and going to anchor to your bones and stimulating the osteoblast. It's not like that. So it's not, don't go for that study. We don't have any criteria for that. Mm-hmm.
Some of the animal experiments do show, because many of the studies, published study, have shown that if you inject this MSC directly into the marrow or stroma, they actually remodel the niche wherever actually they are there, and they respond to the cues where actually they are there. Like suppose you...
So it is the same thing that if you do a brisk walking, you are stimulating your marrow, you are stimulating your MSCs, you are stimulating osteoblast, and your density will increase. It is the same thing.
Yeah.
So, but definitely in human being, I don't feel anybody has tried.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah. Means humans are not for the trying the
correct
investigation. The next question is, generally, what are the bioceramic scaffold used by orthopedicians? So mostly, I think it's a hydroxyapatite that people use.
Hydroxyapatite, yeah.
Yeah. And which is among the scaffolds that you used so far, apart from the titanium alloy?
No, we have used only hydroxyapatite.
Mostly. So do stem cells lose their viability with the age of a person?
It is the same thing. See what happened as the age advances, for the osteoporosis. So as the age advances, the osteoblast, we all know, they decrease, osteoclasts remain the same. So the imbalance is there. So similarly with the aging process, the self-renewing capacity of our MSCs or of our progenitor cell, right? Some is the progenitor cell, that decrease. Mm-hmm. If they decrease, so definitely, the cell load will decrease, the capacity will decrease, the amount will decrease. And with the genetic changes, I think this is a question which you can answer. So the count decreases, that is why the...
So in the lab, what we have done, whenever we isolate the stem cell from the young, mostly less than 18 years old, they proliferate very well. And Definitely. Then and then age, we isolate the even the bone marrow derived stem cell from little mid age or larger, the older age, the proliferation rate goes down.
Definitely.
Even with the same amount of cells that we seed in a flask, the proliferation and the total yield is going to be less in the older patient compared to the younger one. This is absolutely
definitely. That is why we also use, we don't want to use any patient, old patient bone marrow aspirate.
Correct.
His own bone marrow aspirate for any of the assigned job actually.
Yeah. So then another question by Durga is that how long stem cell can be preserved?
So mesenchymal stem cells from the cord, the progenitor cells are being preserved. So, I mean, for how long it can be preserved, I'm not the right person to comment on it. But I prefer, there are so many companies proliferating who preserve these cord with the liquefied nitrogen at a very minimum temperature. And ideally, it can be preserved for many years altogether. But it's very difficult to say that for how long.
Yeah. Very long term that we can say, at least.
But I think the time will tell that whether any, to how much extent they are useful. Hmm. I still feel it is a dicey situation.
And then next question by Sahida is that what are the limitations of using MSC therapy?
Limitation of using?
MSC therapy.
The biggest limitation is if you're using a MSC derived from a cord, or if you're using a MSC derived from adipose tissue, there is not much disadvantage for it because you are using a fresh without any, just using the same MSCs. Definitely for the orthopedic reason, as I've already told you, it is better to use a bone marrow derived, but these MSCs taken from the cord, from the placental tissue, they are wonderfully very well, and they are very good for the autoimmune condition. They are very, very good for the autoimmune condition. Only the legal issues is there. Mm-hmm. But yes, if you're using MSC after culturing them, then definitely till 2 or 3 passages, there is no problem at all. Mm-hmm. And after that, the chance of the mutation is there. So if you want to use MSC, it is better to derive allogenic MSCs from cord, but again, allogenic is a gray zone to be used. But definitely, the publication says that they are better and best for giving a good result.
Yeah. So the one thing that we have in our lab is that till now we have been using these 2D dimension cultures. Okay. So then the question is coming: none of the cells in our body actually sees this kind of artificial environment that we are using for culture. Also, we use a media and media supplement, which have different growth factor in different batches. So invariably by using these culture conditions, we are overfeeding the cells, we are overstimulating the cells, and we never ask the cells how much food actually they would like. And we are just pumping all these growth factors and this, that. And then most important thing is that oxygen condition, even in the highly oxidized blood, RTCL is partial pressure is only 21 to 49 millibar of mercury. If you convert them in percentage term, it turns about 1 to 3%. So if none of the cells in our body except the inner lining of the lung sees the 21% oxygen, we are trying to culture these cells in ambient oxygen, which is 20% oxygen. Again, this is not the cultural condition that ever in vivo cells seas. So definitely, we in future there are areas of in the field where actually we can improve the culture condition, and maybe those cells will do much better than what currently we are able to utilize them for. Definitely, because this we have observed in our lab, and whenever we culture them in 3D and with a hypoxia, where pumping the nitrogen and taking out oxygen and controlling the oxygen culture, they do wonderfully well in differentiation. They do wonderfully well in immune modulation, and they are the one actually they give highest amount of exosome that actually exert the paracrine effect. So definitely, there are things which actually coming out good in our hand if we do. We do and give this cell enough opportunity to succeed. That's the bottom line. If we give more and more opportunity for these cells to succeed, they will do the job what we ask them to do. So another question we will take. Since we have some time, to few minutes.
Sorry to interrupt. Because of the time, shall we finish up?
Sure. It's late in the night. Okay, Dr. Manish. We just get carried away whenever we talk about.
Yeah, it's a very never-ending topic. It's a big topic actually. Okay. It's not possible to cover.
So thank you, Dr. Manish, for.
Sir, thank you so much. Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
On behalf of organizing committee, Vellur Institute of Technology and Swansea University, we thank Dr. Manish Khanna for giving an excellent talk on why we need regenerative medicine in. Regenerative science in modern medicines. And also we would like to thank Indian Stem Cell Study Group Association for collaborating with us for this 3-day Indo-UK virtual conference. I must thank Dr. Sanjay Kumar for being with us, for sharing three sessions in a single day. Thank you very much, sir.
Yes, my pleasure.
Thank you so much. Nearly
600 participants attended this particular session. Thank you all the participants. I request all the participants, please join our tomorrow session starting from 10 a.m. And also tomorrow, we have a special event called Panel Discussion on Challenges and Management of COVID-19. The respected director of National Institute of Pharmaceutical Education and Research, NIPER Kolkata, and Honorable Vice Chancellor, Madurai Kamarajar University, and CEO and Director of CCAMP, Center for Cellular Molecular Platforms, three leading heads of institutions and three other scientists and clinicians are with us for the panel discussion from 2 p.m. to 4 p.m. Please join us for the panel discussion also. Thank you all for participating in many of the sessions. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Levin.
I shall be closing this session.
Yes.
Thank you, sir.